Your Excellencies, honored lectures, ladies and gentlemen, I'm grateful for this invitation to take a part of this symposium of cultural diplomacy in Southeast region. As a preacher of the gospel and as a pastor, I know when is the time when enough is enough. I don't know, you heard so many words in this morning. And I will try to make my presentation shorter as much as I can. First of all, your invitation came as a surprise because I'm not a diplomat or professor. I'm just ordinary member of the society, as well I'm part of small religious community, which is about 0.08% of Croatian population. The power we have is extremely small, so the question is, what can we offer to the society we live in? Or to put in other words, so what I can offer to you who already accomplished a lot in your life, in your careers. I choose for the topic of my speech for today, religious minorities, a burden, a benefit, or a bridge in a society. When we talk about religious minority communities, I first make the statement how they are a burden to society. We live in a world where religious affiliation is not so popular. We are living now when we rather put religious affiliation as a part of civil society. And each secular society wants to limit the influence of religious beliefs and practices in the society. This is the first burden or first limitation.
The second limit is that brought up by religious majority communities. They limit religious minorities in order to keep their position in societies. Religious minorities are disturbing and endangering the monopoly of the major religious communities, and through that they weaken the already declining influence that religious communities have in society. What has changed with regards to history? I had the opportunity to grow up in a soft version of socialist society in which it was made clear to us there are limitations to our religious activities. Religious activities were limited to all religious communities, to our church or our churchyards, just to our sacred spaces. So that the development of society without influence of religion would not be threatened. With this, it was made clear that we were the second-class citizens. When democracy arrived, along with the creation of national states, a silent idea became present that Croats are Catholics, Serbs are Orthodox, Bosniaks are Muslim, and so on and so on. So how can a Croat be a Baptist, or how can a Croat be a Muslim, or Pentecostal, or even Orthodox? That is impossible. Religious identity is equal to national identity, and religious minorities are ruining that picture. Not greatly, but still. The third limitation, or third burden, comes from the religious minority themselves. They limited themselves by shaping their identity in isolation, creating a ghetto mentality, and in that way they closed themselves in their walls. Not knowing how to act in free democratic society, they became slightly lost and a bit disoriented. Realizing that there are certain rights they can now ask for and receive, but not knowing how to do so. They are becoming a burden to the society they live in. Isolated from the society, they are becoming irrelevant to it. Society knows nothing about us, and we know everything about it, so put it in ironic way. Especially religious minority can become burden when they realize that they can sue the state to the European Court for Human Rights and even to get the verdict on their own. So this is how religious minority can become burden to society. And how the religious minority can become benefit to the society. By giving certain freedoms to other religious communities and especially minorities, and image was trying, I'm talking about the past, that the socialist society is ideal free society, socialism tailored to the man. That was how we were grew up in such society. And peaceful and honest citizens, they did their duties and contribute to the building of the new society. Their contribution can be seen especially in some cooperation and some other things. What did that look like in democratic Croatia? Unfortunately, with the democracy came the war. And I will not give here my definition of the war or what I think about the war. It was, we call it here in Croatia, it was homeland war for freedom. And for me as a member, as a religious minority worker, it was not the question, what is my definition of the war? My question was how to react and how to help those who are in the needs. And it was the mention about Mrs. Kosor that during the war she was giving such encouraging program for the refugees. And for all of us, I was living in that time in Sisak, which is north, southeast from Zagreb. It was on the front line, and I was leading the church, which was about 30 believers. And according to the census, we should take care about for 6 refugees. But during the war, we took care for about 1,000 refugees. And in the beginning, we took care, what we call here in Croatia, for displaced people. And in 92, when started the conflict in Bosnia, we took care about the refugees from the Bosnia. And after Operation Storm, we were the first who took care about the elderly people at Banovina region. And this is through the serving those in need and opening toward the society, a lot of religious minorities kept their vitality, multi-ethnicity, and also kept the possibility of becoming or remaining communities of hope and communities of reconciliation. Second thing which I want to mention from the part of the benefit to the society, by allowing other religious communities to act freely, one allows growth, democracy, tolerance, and new democratic society. The Croatian Constitution, in its articles on religious freedom, wants to promote the highest standards of the protection of human rights and religious freedom. However, sometimes it is necessary to let some time pass to get what is written to become part of our reality. But we are on the right track. The Croatian society recognizes the activities of religious communities and allows them to proceed with that activity by forming contracts or agreements with various religious communities. Even though opinions differ on how this relationship between state and religious community should be formed, I share the opinion of my friend from the Islamic religious communities, who was speaker on your event in Rome in March or April, who believe that Croatia is example of relationship, how the state should regulate the relationship with Islamic community. Society can greatly profit from religious minority activities if they are faithful to their mission and serve for the well-being to all, not just to their own believers. Also, by opening towards the societies, minority religious communities are becoming aware of the needs of the people around them, not just their own needs. In that way, society as well as religious community can be useful to one another. And how can minority religious communities can become a bridge in society that can contribute through their activities in several ways? First, by understanding the way the majority sees the minority. Sometimes majority doesn't understand minority, and sometimes minority doesn't understand majority. And I think that the role of minority religious communities is to work and to show that cooperation is possible and understanding, mutual understanding is possible. I will give here as well one more example. In 2009, we as a small religious community start high school in northern Croatia. Just 1 week ago, we have a first graduates. We have 78 students, and actually we are the second largest high school in Croatia, which were founded by religious communities after the classical gymnasium run by Roman Catholic Church. We have 436 students, more than 80 employees. But most of our students are non-Baptist, and most of our employees are non-Baptist. And we are learning how to communicate, we as minority, with those who are majority. And this is very good interaction, and how can we be the bridge in the society. The second thing, in the dialogue and cooperation with the major religious communities, a space is open for the development of religious pluralism or pluralism of the worldviews. In that way, communities can develop their identity, not in isolation, but in dialogue with someone different from themselves. And as a preacher of the gospel, Jesus used the question, who is my neighbor? Today we can use the other question, who is my other? We can read about it in philosophy of Jewish philosopher Martin Buber, and also in the great today Croatian theologian Miroslav Volf, who wrote awarded work, his book Exclusion and Embrace, an exploration on identity, otherness, and reconciliation. I think that small religious communities or minority religious communities can contribute in mutual understanding of all of us. On other way, the contributing to society is by removing the fear minorities feel in the face of majority and vice versa. In my conclusion, I can say religious minorities can be a burden, a benefit, and a bridge at the same time. If we are open to get to know each other, our beliefs and our activities, then we can accept and respect one another. In the end, I would like to finish with a quote of Martin Luther King Jr., the great advocate for the human rights, winner of the Nobel Prize for Peace, but who was also a Baptist preacher, who said in one of his sermons the following: all men are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in the single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. And you can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be. This is the interrelated structure of reality. Thank you very much.